Hello, everybody, and welcome to today's webinar. Today, we're going to talk about gene and protein, chemical names, and aliases, synonyms, and other confusing terms. Rana Morris is going to be giving the webinar. This is Peter Cooper. And the directory for the slides and for that Q&A document will be on that FTP site there, and that GoUSA compressed URL will take you there. So I'm going to turn this over to Rana now, and she's going to talk about chemical and protein and gene names and aliases.
Hi and welcome. This NCBI Minute is based on two Insights blog posts on topics that many users have asked us about previously. I'll show you how to find those blog posts at the end of the presentation. As science progresses, what we call things can change over time. Gene symbols, protein names, that what we call chemical compounds. This can be confusing, not just when conversing about scientific research, but particularly when looking for and at articles that have been published over time. In this NCBI Minute, I'll give a couple of quick examples about how the use of names and terms can be confusing, show you how NCBI deals with this issue in-house, where we put the information on our web pages so that others can benefit from our work, and show you some of the FTP files that you can download if you want to get this information in bulk. Two of the main groups that handle this nomenclature issues here at NCBI deal specifically with assigning terms for genes and proteins and chemical compounds. A classic example of a problem with gene symbols is shown here. I found a paper published in 1999 describing the effect of a gene product called P21-SDL1 in four different cancer cell lines. In 2010, another paper described the gene P21-CYP1 in a CML cancer cell line study. 2 years later, P21-WAIF1 was examined for its effect with estrogen receptor alpha in six breast cancer cell lines. These genes are actually the same. There are many papers that have actually concatenated these terms in various combinations, CYP1-WAIF1, WAIF1-SDL1, P21-CYP1. It's not even really just use based on evolution of the term through time, since there was a publication back in 1994 which actually concatenated all of the various possibilities together in one swell swoop. Last year, a publication came out describing the effect of CDKN1A on thyroid cancer. Guess what? It's also the same gene. In fact, the official gene symbol is designated by the Human Gene Nomenclature Committee is actually this CDKN1A, which is the symbol for cyclin-dependent kinase inhibitor 1A. All the other terms that have been used are now known as aliases or synonyms or also known as terms for the same gene and gene product, which in this case is a protein. A similar and perhaps more long-running problem has occurred in the world of chemicals. Here's the most accurate name for a chemical. Actually, it's the 2D view of the atomic structure. But early in its research life, it was designated with various code terms. When the structure is known, it can have an official nomenclature designated name, IUPAC, as example. And there's often a registry number designated for it, like this CAS registry number. Over time, this particular compound was identified as an important one and given a more easily pronounceable and marketable name, Tamoxifen, although various companies decided to sell it, sell forms of it under other names. So what do you do with all of this? How do you look things up in a literature search? What do you search with if you actually want to find something to buy? So how does NCBI deal with this situation? We'll start with genes and proteins. We have a curation group at NCBI called REFSEQ, the Reference Sequence Project. This is a group of curators who examine the literature and work with collaborators in the community along with automated data gathering processes to compile a list of terms that have been used for a particular gene or protein. This includes an officially designated gene symbol and protein name when one exists, along with all of the other terms that have been used for it in the literature in reputable databases such as UniProt, PDB, and SwissProt, and from submissions from experts in the field. We display compiled lists of all of these records in the gene database. Gene symbols are shown in the summary section at the top of the page with the official gene symbols designated, and others that have been used are listed in the also known as section. Protein names are listed in the general protein information names section with an official name designated along with others shown below. Here's an example for the CDKN1A gene. Here's the gene page for CDKN1A, the human version. Just to remind you, there is a table of contents in the gene database on the right-hand side that lists all the sections on this record. In the top section is the summary, which lists the official gene symbol and protein name. The organization that made this decision is listed right here. In this case, this was decided by the Human Gene Nomenclature Committee, the HGNC. Other alias gene symbols that have been used throughout history are listed in the also known as section. Further down the page, you'll find the protein names listed in the General Protein Information section under names and preferred names. While the RefC group deals with genes and proteins, we have another group at NCBI that deals with chemicals. The PubChem group has automated processes that aggregate all of those terms that have been used for chemical compounds. Aliases or synonyms for chemicals are compiled from mesh indexing curators at the NLM and from submitters of chemical data to PubChem. In addition, you may remember from your old organic chemistry class that there are several different nomenclatures used for chemicals based on their atomic structure. We have a software program that will actually compute these terms based on the chemical structure. These are called descriptors. These include our old friend or nemesis, IUPAC, as well as several others such as INCHI, INCHI Key, SMILES, and SMARTS. Finally, we aggregate identifiers that were used by various organizations, such as the FDA's UNI term, the EU's European Chemical Agency's number, and others. These are placed on the PubChem compound record pages in the names and identifiers section. Here's an example for tamoxifen. PubChem compound page for tamoxifen is shown. The record has a top summary section, which is pretty helpful. PubChem does put its table of contents on the left-hand side, listing all of its sections, and they are expandable for a multi-level outline view. In the third section that lists those names and identifiers that have been aggregated and calculated, first come the computed descriptors, which are generated from the chemical structure, IUPAC, INCHI, INCHI Key, and so on. Then below that is the other identifiers list, including CAS registry number, when we have the information, an EC number, and the FDA's UNI number, for example. Then there's a synonym section, including all those compiled by mesh curators at the NLM, and a list collected from all of the submitters of information to PubChem. Note that you can also download the information in this record at the top of the page. You can also do this back on the gene record page. But what if you want to download not just one gene or chemicals information, but a whole bunch of it all at one time? Back to genes and proteins. In addition to displaying those also known as and names directly on the gene record pages, the RefC group also produces several files that they regularly update on the NCBI FTP site. These are tab-separated files containing text with lots and lots of information and includes gene symbols and protein names, among a lot of other cool stuff. They are called gene info files. Here's the full path to find the gene info files on our FTP site. To help visualize this, they are located in the gene directory, in the data folder, in the gene info subfolder. You can get the all data geneinfo.gz file, which provides lots of information for all the organisms listed in the gene database. Alternatively, you can get an organism-specific file, which is much smaller and, frankly, what most people want. For example, under Mammalia subfolder, you can select the Homo sapiens geneinfo.gz file to get only the information about human genes. Notice that we also have files specifically designated for mouse, rat, dog, etc. Also, please note that these are pretty large gzip compressed files. What do these files look like? Well, they are 15 tab-separated columns with lots of information. I've turned the table over 90 degrees and have shown only a few columns here because I think it makes it easier for you to see what they have. Here's an example of data pertaining to that CDKN1A gene or cyclin-dependent kinase inhibitor 1A that I showed you earlier, showing the gene database identifier number, a bunch of symbols, and then the names designated for that particular gene product. Please note that the organism-specific ones are easily importable into Excel or parsable with even much more helpful data about the genes that I'm not showing you here. But you can keep, discard, or reorganize those columns in Excel or by parsing however you want. While gene and protein information is the charge of the RefSeq group, remember the chemical information is gathered by the PubChem group, and they are displayed on the PubChem compound records. The PubChem group also produces helpful Ftp files, which are perhaps even more easy to use to correlate synonyms for chemical compounds. There's a single file on the NCBI Ftp site which actually has only two tab-separated columns with a PubChem compound identifier, or CID, in the first column, and then a corresponding synonym on the second. However, if you're interested in all those other names and terms for chemicals, computer descriptors, and identifiers, you'll need to download a full PubChem compound database record file to get those. So where are they? Here's the full path to find the PubChem files on our Ftp site. Again, to help visualize this, they are located in the PubChem directory, in the compound folder, and then there is an extras folder that has a whole lot of really nice and helpful files. You can access the CID synonym filtered GZ file down here at the bottom to get a cleaned list of all the synonyms provided to PubChem for chemical compounds. The gzipped compressed file is pretty big, almost a gigabyte, but it's a simple file containing only two columns, the CID, compound identifier, and the synonym. There are other files in this extras folder that may be of interest, such as the CID mesh file, which shows only the single mesh preferred term for the chemical, which we use for the name at the top of the PubChem compound records. For all those other computed descriptors and identifiers, you'll need to go to the compound current full record files. They are produced in several formats, so you can get whichever one is best for you, ASN1, XML, or SDF. Here's an example of the portion for the tamoxifen data in an SDF formatted file. Embedded in the data are IUPAC names, INSHI key terms, SMILES terms, and lots of other data. Now, you don't have to remember all of this or even watch this video again if you don't want to. All of this information has already been written up with descriptions and links in two NCBI Insights blog posts. The NCBI Insights blog provides information about NCBI resources with tips and tricks to help you use our site and make cool discoveries. One NCBI Insights blog post fully explains how to get the also known as terms for genes and proteins. Another talks about how to get chemical synonyms and even mentions simple APIs that you can use if you prefer to using those rather than downloading large files. I've included bit.ly links here to make them easy to find, but you can always check in on or search the NCBI Insights blog site for more cool tips and tricks. Many helpful how-tos videos are, and this one will also be added shortly to our YouTube channel. And as always, if you have any questions about or need help with our resources, please send an email to our help desk at info@ncbi.nlm.nih.gov. Thanks for your attention.
Thanks, Rana. We have time for a few questions. I see that I answered one in the question spot that I think everybody has seen the answer to that. The other one was about where we can get a copy of the slide deck. That will be linked to our webinars and courses page. Well, actually, that bit.ly link on the cover of the front slide has that. I'll get that into the questions pod in just a minute. Okay, we have one more question that's in the questions pod. It's how often do the gene and protein database update the synonym identifiers?
I'm not sure about the gene. I'll have to get back to you on that. PubChem actually updates those files every day. When new information comes in, it takes a couple of days to process. And then that file is literally updated every, I think, 7 p.m. at night or so. So that's constantly updated. I believe the gene record is updated a little less frequently, but still pretty well, and we can find that information out for you. If you send an email in to info@ncbi, we'll be happy to get that information for you.
And I've sent out the compressed URL to that FTP site that has the slide deck to everyone. Okay, and another listener from NCBI has chimed in the question spot. The gene info file on the FTP site seems to be updated daily as well. Okay, I don't see any other questions, and we're out of time, so I'm going to go ahead and wrap up the webinar. Thank you for attending, and Rana, thank you for providing this webinar, and we'll see you next time.